has been sentenced to life imprisonment. Running some honeymoon, Zhou Yongkang has been sentenced to jail and he has disclosed all the details of the corruption.
He's...
我不上诉。我认识到自己违法犯罪的事实给党的事业造成的损失，我再次表示认罪悔罪。你如何准备你的贪污大忌呢？当我还在领导中石油和国土资源部的时候，我拥有很多的下属为我办事，我的家人也在石油公司上班。之后我升迁到了四川。 公安部部长和中央政法委书记的位置后，有更多的追随者，他们可以为我所用，他们也不敢不上缴。私下的我与中央军委副主席徐才厚也很熟络，颇有交情。
就是我想问，就是你说什么方法或者是途径来获取这样巨大的那个金钱的利益呢？
在我的影响下。 我的儿子周斌和我妻妹成了中石油和能源科技公司的核心管理人员，他们会从不同的采购程序中取收取利益。如果中石油进行采购程序，中石油的总经理蒋杰敏将会通知我的儿子周斌，他会联络他的岳母、投标和重要，之后由我们高下卖回中石油以。 赚取利润，然后钱会汇去瑞士银行洗钱。国务院的资金和下属的进贡也是我的摇钱树，他们给我钱，我会帮助他们晋升、升利和陶醉，就好像另计划这样。而且我还要养情妇，钱是不能缺少的。
The inspectors discovered that he owns numerous properties, gold, renminbi, foreign cashes, cars, artwork, guns, and financial products estimated over $100 billion. Okay, that's it. Has an interview with the experienced new analyst to see what happened.
Mr. Chen, I'm curious why such severe corruption will occur in China. What are the facilitative factors?
Oh, actually, from the economic perspective, the state-owned enterprises are not well managed. During the reform and opening up, the leaders of state-owned enterprises still own a huge power in decision-making. The managers misuse their power to conduct corrupt activities, like increasing their own salaries or misappropriation of public funds for private material gains. Like in Zhou Yongkang's case, he was in charge of China National Petroleum Corporation in the past, and he misused his power to transfer the state properties and assets to the companies of his relatives.
Yes, besides, the process of privatization is also a matter. During privatization, the states can transfer the state-owned enterprises and land resources to the private enterprises. When the state-owned enterprises and governments need to build new infrastructures and provide new services, they need to make contracts with some private and state-owned enterprises. In this process, the corrupt officials will receive bribery or benefits from the rich and transfer the state access and procurement contracts to them. For example, like the son of Zhou Yongkang, Zhou Bin, owned an enterprise and he could sell equipment to the CNPC because he was Zhou Yongkang's son and has a very close relationship with him.
Yeah, apart from the economic aspect, are any other aspects are also influential?
Oh, of course. From a cultural perspective, by consumerism, the egalitarian and socialist ideas is actually fading out in China. Being more materialistic, people hope to earn more money and live more luxuriously and do so by corruption. Besides, the deep-rooted Guangxi culture, which reverses the gift-giving and banquet behavior, will also be a chance for corrupt officials to build a very reliable network of corruption. For example, like Zhou Yongkang's case, he and his family members actually transfer benefits to each other by reliable family ties. As Zhou Yongkang was in charge of the government in Sichuan province, the CNPC and the National Security and Surveillance, he built very strong corrupt networks with many colleagues and subordinates. And actually, the subordinates also helped Zhou Yongkang for corruption. Finally, the political aspect is also very important. because the highly centralized power structure fosters corruption. The local governments and the state-owned enterprises is highly centralized in a small group of leaders, and these leaders are powerful in urging subordinates to cooperate with them in some corrupt practices. And these leaders can also use their power to control economic policies and personal issues in the local government. Therefore, they can easily give economic benefits to others, giving important positions by buying and selling offices. Besides, there is also a lack of monitoring from free press, civil society, and independent legislature. Thus, China government is increasing central government's leadership on local CDIC in order to allow the local CDIC to monitor the provincial government. And the local CDIC action is still highly controlled and influenced by the higher authority. Therefore, CDIC is not actually very independent enough.
What are the impacts of this case?
Oh, the corruption committed by Zhu Yongkang is actually bringing the huge economic loss to the state and society. Previously, the amount of estimation was $100 billion and later being changed to $1 billion by, I don't know what is the value. And however, it is still also a huge amount which can be utilized in welfare use or just community development. Besides, the corruption also harms social order and legal justice. For example, like in the Ling Tihua case, Zhu Yongkang actually receives benefits from him and provides protection from prosecution. This is actually detrimental to the laws, rules of law and social justice in China. Money seems to be the solution of all criminals. Apart from the above, the poor bureaucracy also creates an unhealthy concept that Guanxi is the key to promotion instead of the achievement and effort, which does not facilitate the growth of healthy atmosphere in government setting. Finally, the case explores the myth of no tigers will be touched on the roof and boost the confidence in the presidency's anti-corruption campaign.
Any solutions to this thorny and deep-rooted problem?
Oh yes, of course. Actually, the multiplication of anti-corruption agencies are actually useful. The central disciplinary inspection commissions is now for the party discipline and the local DIC branches down to grassroots. The Ministry of Supervision is inspecting and investigating offenses of administrative disciplines, recommend and impose administrative sanctions. For the procuratorate, it carries investigatory and prosecution functions. It is suggested that more independent organizations should be set up to suppress corruption by the party. Privileges will be given to the investigation and transparency should be increased by the public tribunals. And the boarding nets that defines the jurisdiction of discipline inspection committees gives DIC's authority to investigate and punish misconduct that is not so serious as to constitute crime. The close cooperation between the DICs and the procuratories allows legal penalties to be imposed on more serious crimes. Besides, the punishment systems can also be improved, because nowadays the criminal laws leave the greatest discretion of the penalties, and more concrete and more clear penalties should be clarified. And the existing situation is few cases are imposed on the high-ranking officials.
That's the end of our news.